Good morning, everyone. My name is Daniel, and I'm one of the pastors here at MPC. I'm the pastor of Lay Church, which is the evening service that meets here on a Sunday night. And it's my great privilege to be able to bring God's Word to us this morning. But first, we're going to read from Acts chapter 4. Acts chapter 4, which is on page 1093 of the church Bibles, if you've got one of them. Over the last term, we've been working our way through this series, One Story, Ten Questions. And we've been working our way through the story of the Bible, starting right at the beginning in creation and working our way until finally, the last 2 weeks, we came to the climax of God's plan to send Jesus, his only son, into the world to die in our place on a cross, but only to rise 3 days later, demonstrating his power over death itself. But that's not the end of God's plan, because it continues. It's only just the beginning. And so here in Acts chapter 4, we see God's mission, his plan, continues to go out to the world. So read with me from Acts chapter 4, verses 1 to 20. Now the priest and the captain of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to Peter and John while they were speaking to the people. They were greatly disturbed because the apostles were teaching the people, proclaiming in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. And they seized Peter and John, and because it was evening, they put them in jail until the next day. But many who heard the message believed. So the number of men who believed grew to about 5,000. Now the next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. And as the high priest was there, and so was Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others of the high priest's family. They had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. By what power or what name do you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. Now when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus. But since they couldn't see the man who had been healed standing there with them, there was nothing that they could say. So they ordered them to withdraw from the Sanhedrin and then conferred together. What are we going to do with these men, they asked. Everyone living in Jerusalem knows that they have performed a notable sign and we cannot deny it. But to stop this thing from spreading any further among the people, we must warn them to speak no longer to anyone in this name. Then they called them in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, Which is right in God's eyes, to listen to you or to him? You be the judges. But as for us, we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and heard. Before we get into hearing from God's word, why don't I pray for us now, ask God to help us. Our gracious Father, Lord, we thank you that you have spoken through your word. Lord, we thank you that you continue to speak to us through it. Father, we pray as we hear from it now, this morning, that you would be preparing our hearts and our minds. Lord, help us to be obedient to what you have to say. Lord, and help us to live it out in our lives as well. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm not sure if you're aware or not, but there is an ongoing debate in our nation about the place of religious education in our schools. Just yesterday, there was an opinion piece in the Brisbane Times that called for all religious classes in schools to be abolished because it was seeking to proselytize kids. The article said this. It said, Windsor State School has banned the Connect religious instruction classes following a review by the principal. In a letter to parents, Principal Matthew Keong explains how the lessons contravene religious instruction policy by attempting to convert children to Christianity. He says, Connect's materials go beyond imparting knowledge of biblical references and extend to soliciting children to develop a personal faith in God and Jesus. The review has found the Connect program in breach of the policy that prohibits proselytizing, defined as soliciting a student for a decision to change their religious affiliation. And this is not a unique opinion piece. A public opinion is starting to question the place of Christianity, not only in our schools, but in nearly every area of public life. And their concern seems to be around this word proselytizing. This word proselytizing simply means seeking to make converts. It's basically just a code word for any attempt to convert someone to your way of thinking or your religion. And it's on the nose for a lot of people. And I think you could probably understand why, can't you? I mean, who here, you got to be honest, who here enjoys receiving those phone calls by a telemarketer at maybe around 7 o'clock in the middle of the night, just as you're about to sit down and have dinner, trying to convince you to change phone plans or your electricity providers? Now, can anyone here honestly say that they enjoy those phone calls at night? And I think for many people, that's the exact same mindset that they have about religion. See, it's okay for you to believe what you want, but don't try and push it down my throat. I'm not buying. See, I think on the whole, our society would prefer if we all just kept our religious bents to ourselves. It's good for you. We can respect that, but as long as it doesn't impinge on us. And I wonder, should Christians actually heed these requests? After all, they aren't asking us to completely give up our faith. They're just asking that Christians aren't as public about it, and that we stop trying to convince others to convert. Is that really such a big thing to ask? Isn't that just normal courtesy? After all, isn't it intolerant not to respect the beliefs and religions of other people? Well, these aren't new objections at all. They're the very same objections that were addressed to the first followers of Jesus nearly 2,000 years ago. And so this morning, we're going to go back to the very start of the Christian church in the book of Acts to see how they responded to these same accusations. So turn with me now, if you've got your Bibles in front of you, to Acts chapter 1, just a couple of pages back from the reading that was read for us. Now, Jesus has died, but he's been raised to life again, and he's gathered his disciples together, and he tells them that his work is not yet finished. He's about to leave, but he has a mission for them to do. Pick it up with me from verse 7 of chapter 1. And Jesus said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." See, Jesus, he kind of gives his disciples here a mission statement to go out and be his witnesses, starting from the city of Jerusalem where they are, and then to the nation of Israel as a whole, and then to all the nations throughout the world. See, he's saying it's not enough that you just go tell people here in Jerusalem. You need to go out and tell people from every nation, from all people groups, who Jesus is and what he's done. You see, and despite what some people might say, it's not for political gain, or it's not motivated by power-hungry dominance. No, something truly life-changing has just happened, has just taken place. And Jesus' followers are to make sure that everyone hears about it, so that everyone has an opportunity to share life with Jesus. And so that's exactly what the rest of Acts, this book of Acts, is all about. These people sharing who Jesus is in Jerusalem, in Israel, and to the ends of the earth. But why? Well, what reasons, what motivation is given for working against the status quo, for pushing beyond the personal religion, for convincing others to follow Jesus? Well, move forward with me to Acts 4, the reading that was read for us. Because here we see two of the same men that Jesus has just been talking to in chapter 1, following through on this mission. Peter and John, they haven't moved too far from where we left them in chapter 1. They're still in Jerusalem, but they're speaking to anyone who will listen to them about who Jesus is. And they've done some pretty miraculous things as well. They've healed dozens of people, and thousands are becoming Christians. But the religious and the political leaders of the day have taken wind of the movement, and they're not too happy about it. And you can probably understand why. Because these are the same leaders who only just a month earlier had sentenced Jesus to death. And then suddenly there's a whole bunch of people traveling around claiming that this man, Jesus, who they put to death, is alive. And so these leaders, they do the most natural thing that they can think of. They throw Peter and John into prison, and they tell them to remain silent, to be quiet, to shut up. But Peter and John refuse. And it's here where we find three foundational reasons, I think, why Christians won't ever stop sharing about Jesus, and why it's important not to. And those reasons are: it's necessary, it's natural, and it's non-negotiable. Well, I think the first reason is found in verse 12. Peter builds up to it from verse 8 when he is asked by these leaders and religious men, by what power or in what name are you proselytizing and healing people? Well, Peter doesn't miss his cue here at all, and he responds and he says, "Know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands healed." That we are doing all these things, that we are sharing out the gospel. He spells it out for them in a way that they really can't miss. He says in verse 12, "Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." And you can see that the ruling council could see the implications of this claim straight away. And we need to make sure that we are clear on the implications of this claim too. See, Acts 4:12 says that the only way to know God, to be rescued by God, and to enjoy God forever is through this man, Jesus Christ. See, Peter is making a bold, bold statement here, and it has massive implications. See, firstly, he's saying that not all religions lead to God. If Acts 4:12 is true, then by definition, all other religions, ultimately, they just don't deliver. Now, that's not to say that they don't say some helpful things at times, or that everyone who follows them is a horrible person. But if Jesus is the only name under heaven by which we can be rescued, then people who are calling on other names, well, they're just barking up the wrong tree. And that's tragic. Well, secondly, I think we need to understand from this is that we all need to be rescued. See, if Acts 4:12 is true, then everyone who is not a Christian is still in grave danger and needs to be rescued. And lastly, what Peter is saying here is that any form of sincerity, whether that be belief or spirituality or being religious, is not enough. The strength of our feelings or the depth of our piety or the frequency of our practice cannot rescue us. Only Jesus can. Trusting in Jesus' name, that is, in who he is and what he has done for us, is the only way that anyone can be saved. If Jesus is who he claims to be and who the Bible says he is, it does and it will matter because it means that life and freedom and joy, salvation itself, is found in no one else but Jesus. Peter is saying that sharing who Jesus is with others, even proselytizing, is necessary because the only way to know God is through Jesus. It's that stark. If you don't know Jesus, you don't know God, and you don't know life. And so it's necessary that we do go out and share who Jesus is. But secondly, it's also natural. Now, when I was at uni, I used to work part-time at a cinema at Fox Studios in Sydney. And if you've ever been to one of those gold-class cinemas, it was pretty much the same kind of feel. You know, those cinemas where you pay a small fortune to go in to a private lounge area to order some food and drinks that also cost a fortune from a bar, and then you're ushered in to these massive cushiony seats where you can recline and you watch the movie on. Now, one of the unique things about the cinema that I was working at Fox Studios was that the variety of famous people who would walk through the doors. So during my time there, there were a whole lot of celebrities. Jennifer Hawkins, Hugh Jackman, Nicole Kidman, even politicians like John Howard. But I think the most exciting one that I ever met was Daniel Craig. You know, James Bond, the actor who plays James Bond, Daniel Craig. And I think after every one of these encounters, I'd be boasting about it with anyone who would listen for at least the next month. It was at the start of every conversation. Oh, guess what? The other day, I met Daniel Craig. When a Bond movie came out, oh, yeah, I met him. He's not as tall as you think he is. But anyway. But you start talking about it, don't you? And it's a logical response. If you've run into a celebrity or something amazing has happened to you, you immediately tweet about it, or you message, or your Facebook or Snapchat or whatever social media that the kids are using today, you're going to tell people about it. And you want to share about it. When you see someone famous, you want other people to know. When you bump into greatness, you want other people to know your brush with fame. Well, Jesus, he's not just a celebrity, he's God himself. And it's not just popularity statuses that he's handing out. He's offering eternal life, offering an end to pain and suffering, a real relationship with God, the God who created the entire universe. He's offering salvation. It was so natural for me to want to share my brush with fame with meeting Daniel Craig. But why wouldn't I share the same enthusiasm to tell others about my relationship with Jesus, to tell others who Jesus is, that he is the Lord over all creation? And I think that's the exact same reasoning that Peter and John give to the religious leaders here in Acts chapter 4. So you pick it up with me from verse 18. And the religious leaders called Peter and John back in again and commanded them not to speak or teach at all in the name of Jesus. But Peter and John replied, "Which is right in God's eyes, to listen to you or to him? You be the judges. But as for us, we cannot help speaking about what we have seen and what we have heard." See, it would be illogical not to share what they had seen. Jesus had died, and he had been raised up to life. He appeared to them alive again. He had shown them all the proof that they needed to demonstrate that he was exactly who he claimed to be, God himself. And now he's here offering salvation to anyone who will accept him. Let me put it starkly. It's either true or it's false that God walked amongst us in Jesus. It's either true or it's false that he offers us forgiveness through his death. It's either true or it's false that his resurrection gives us life. And if these things are false, then logically we should shut up, sell up, and give all the money that we have to solving human poverty or finding cures for cancer or saving the whales or any other countless worthwhile organizations that you can think of. But if these things are true, that God made the earth, that he sustains it, that he walked amongst us in Jesus, that he died on a cross so that we might be forgiven. If it's true that he rose from the dead, defeating the power of death and offers us eternal life. If these things are true, isn't it natural that we would want to share that with others? That we want other people to know the life that we have in Jesus? If you believe that God is Lord, that Jesus offers forgiveness, you can't help but speak about it. But even if it is necessary, even if it is natural for us to talk about Jesus, I'm sure there are still some people out there who won't want us to share Jesus at all. And I'm sure there are many Christians here this morning who still aren't keen on the idea of sharing Jesus either. And believe me, I'm talking about myself here as well. See that story about how I've mixed with celebrities, with Daniel Craig? As I was saying, I've managed to bring that into conversation with nearly everyone that I meet. But have I been as excited and as open about Jesus? Now, of course, professionally, I have. I'm a minister. How much more public do you want to get than your profession of sharing the gospel? But it doesn't mean that I don't struggle sharing Jesus, sharing my faith when any opportunity arises. And why? It's because I think I suffer from a severe case of people pleasing. I don't know, I wonder if you suffer from the same disease, people pleasing. I'm more interested in talking about Daniel Craig because I'm sure others want to hear about him. And let's be honest, they don't always want to hear about Jesus. But if God really has intervened into our world through Jesus Christ, if he made us and loves us and has our lives in his hands, we need to obey him and not other people. It's non-negotiable. And which is why Peter and John say what they do in verse 18. See, when offered their freedom, conditional on shutting up about Jesus, Peter and John reply, "Judge for yourselves whether it is right in God's sight to obey you rather than God." See, Peter and John realize that because God is God and has acted for our good and his glory in Jesus, then of course they will obey God rather than listen to mere humans. But if you're anything like me and you struggle with this, then we need to ask God to work the fact that Jesus Christ is Lord and that salvation is found in him alone, even deeper into our hearts and into our minds. See, we have the Spirit, just as Peter and John did. We have the message of Jesus who has changed the world. We don't need anything new, and we certainly don't need anything more. We simply need God to change our minds, to bring us into line with the truth, to help us to see the world through his eyes, through the lens of the gospel. We need to ask God to help us to believe what we already know. We need to trust Jesus and to live to please him rather than ourselves or other people. Now, Christianity has always been a missionary faith. From the very birth of the church, Christians have been told to go out and to share Jesus with other people in the hope that others might also become Christian. It's at the core of who Christians are. And if you are here this morning and you think that there is no place for Christians to speak about Jesus in the public sphere, then please hear this. Christians don't speak up and make a nuisance of themselves simply because they think they're pretty awesome or because they like the sound of their own voices. But we speak and we try and share who Jesus is because we genuinely believe that God has done something in this man, Jesus Christ. That he is God's son and that he offers salvation and life to anyone who will trust him. And it's from this conviction that Christians have and that they will continue to speak up because we believe it is necessary, it is natural, and it's non-negotiable. It's not from intolerance or general disregard for others that we speak up. No, it's born from our love of others and conviction that Jesus is the only way in which anyone can be saved, the only way to know God, and so we plead with others out of love for them that they might come to know Jesus. And if you are here this morning and you are a Christian, we need to remember who Jesus is. We need to be bold in making Jesus and his salvation known. And I'm not saying at this point that we all need to be like Peter, who boldly speaks before a group of men who were intent on keeping him silent and could have killed him. But we are all called to be ready to speak, to be able to explain who Jesus is, and to give an answer to the hope that we have in him. So why don't we pray about that now? Gracious Father, Lord, we thank you that you sent your Son into this world, Lord, that through his death and his resurrection, Lord, that he died for us in our place so that we might have life. Father, we thank you for the mission that Jesus told his disciples to go on, to share his name to all other people, so that many of us here might hear the gospel and know life in you. Father, help us to be convicted by what we know. Help us to want to go out and share who Jesus is with those around us. Lord, and we pray that we might do this for your glory. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.